Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you once again for this wonderful privilege where we can put our toils to one side. And Lord, we thank you that you brought us here with a specific purpose to worship, to uplift your name, and also to study your word. And Lord, as we now step into our classes and as we discuss and deliberate on the Holy Scriptures, Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit will be amongst us, and we especially pray, Father, that the teachers' minds will be inspired so that they can deliver the right information and the right dialogue with the rest of the congregation, Lord. We ask this in your precious name. Amen.
We thank you so much, Lord, for your kindness towards us. We thank you, God, because even when we are perplexed, we are not cast down. You are near us, Lord, lifting us up, taking care of us, Father. Lord, this morning, we have studied how much, Lord, your grace covers us, your mercy extend upon us, Father. Thank you for everything that has been said and done, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that as we venture into the next part of the service, that your Holy Spirit will still continue to be with us, Lord. Let us open our hearts to receive it, because he is here, Lord, waiting to bless us abundantly. Thank you for your mercy and your grace. And dismiss us now. And may we stay reverent in your house. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Have a blessed now, John.
Okay, we pray for your family. You know, sometimes in life we have so many issues and so many problems, and all we can ever do is fall on our knees and pray to our Lord. You know, so many things that happen are beyond our control, but thankfully we have a God who is always looking out for our best interests. So we will sing one stanza of Sweet Hour of Prayer, and I will ask Sister Winters to pray for us.
Into this church this morning, that we can talk to you because we know you are here. There are many brethren here, Father, who are sick. You're the balm in Gilead, and you said we should cast all our cares upon you because you care for us. There's no doubt about this, Father, because we know that miracles has been performed here many times. Words cannot express it, dear Lord, but you know our heart's desire, that you are loving, a compassionate Father, and the one who cares and knows our needs. The names have been mentioned to you this morning, Father, because of limited knowledge. All the names cannot be mentioned, but it's already mentioned before you. So we ask, Lord, that you will stretch out your healing arms and touch according to your will. We put before you Brother Otis' mother in the hospital of affliction. Father, we know that you are there. We ask, dear Lord, that you will come divinely near to Sister Greenaway. And just lift her up and help her, dear Lord, that the problems that she's undergoing at this moment will be solved, because you are ever solving, loving God. We come before you, dear Father, there's a bit of mocking touch. Was hit down by a car He was actually given over by the doctor. But when the news came to us recently that he's back on his feet, eating, drinking, and laughing. There are so many names that was called this morning, dear Father. Can't many remember the names, but Father, you know. You understand, you are the God who touch and the God who heals. The God who raised people from the dead. And we know when we call upon you, dear Lord, you will never neglect us. Because we are casting our cares upon you, and we know that you will answer prayer. We ask you, dear Lord, that there will come divinely near today. And there are many hearts, dear Father, who are beating heart of beating because they are a bit shy, cannot mention their problems. But I know you understand. We ask the dear Lord that thou will grant us your peace, forgive us of our sins or unworthiness, because we are free human beings, but we know, dear Father, when we call upon you, you're ready to answer our prayers. So as we lift them up this morning, we ask the dear Lord that you will answer our weakness. Give us strength. Help that we may face the crisis with no problem, because we know that you are God who answers them. And we are leaving them at your feet this morning, God, because we know that you are ever-loving Father. You are a God who answers our question. You are a God who feeds us, the one who provides for us clothing, the one who took us to church this morning, and we are depending on you that you will never let us down. So we ask, Heavenly Father, that you will hear and answer our prayer this morning, because we ask in it through your loving name, with thanksgiving and praise, same thanks, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
It's in the first and the last stanza. Going home in a little while, you would sing in a certain fashion.
in your presence, we humbly bow our heads and we open our hearts. We approach your throne through the blood of Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, bless our worship. May thy Spirit fall upon us and help us to feel the touch of the bosom of Jesus Christ. Shower of blessing, not the drops, but the shower, please. Bless your people and accept our worship in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Let us get saved.
Amen. Thank you for his family. Most of them are here to support him. We pray that you'll bless them. And Lord, as we meet together here, give us the joy of meeting with you and that great day when you shall come to take the saints home. Help that each of us will be there. So forgive us now and cleanse us, empower us with your Holy Spirit. And what we fail of asking you, dear Lord, in your mercy, please fail not to grant it unto us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. And it was taken from Galatians 5. 16 and 17. This is God's word. Families here to support him, and not only to support him but to take part. Wilfred is playing the piano, Conscience did his children's story, Crystal and Crystal, yes, did the meditation, and I can see Alfred here, Sister Masih. Has anybody else worked with family? We are so glad to have you, and you know, Pastor Masih is not a stranger to us here. He's one of the main architects in us getting this building. And you know, we must thank God for him. And I know Pastor Masih has done a lot of work here in Birmingham and other parts. And Pastor Masih, we are glad to have you with us here and we present to you the call.
Happy Sabbath. Very poor, happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath. That's better. It's nice to be here. And what time do you want to go home? Well, all right. Time is running. In the book of Revelation, chapter 19, when God's people are singing, are worshiping in heaven, and from the congregation we see that three slogans coming up. And they say, praise the Lord. Can you say that?
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
But then we find during the service, I'm sure Christ is conducting that service, another slogan comes from the congregation and it says, hallelujah. Very poor. Hallelujah! And then we find the last one, the slogan comes from the congregation. And everybody says, Amen!
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 Well, I hope you don't think that Pastor Masih is becoming Pentecostal. It's not that when we read there, and I'm sure by the grace of God, we will be there as singing. And new things would be revealed to us through Jesus during his sermon. And naturally, we will be saying, praise God, hallelujah, amen. So we should practice that when we are here. I'd like to appreciate Crystal. Thank you for supporting that. And granddad. I have a little one here in the hands of Alfred, my another grandson. He just come back from India. I would tell Wilford and Alfred to remind him when he grows that granddad used to say, thank you for coming to the church. My brother, it's very serious topic today. If you have read the bulletin, what the topic is?
Take gifts, but bring fruit. Take gifts, but bring fruit.
Yes. Take the gift, but bring the fruit. Take the gift and bring the fruit. I'd like to say that how many have you got your Bible in your hand? Let me see that if you have the Bible. Lift it, please. Lift it. Lift it. Lift it. Shake it a little bit. Thank you. Now we are going to read together. I want you to look into the letter to the Ephesians in the New Testament. Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. We read from verse 8 to 12. And we'll be reading together. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8 to 12. Okay, it's King James, which I'm reading, says, wherefore, have you got it?
Yes.
Wherefore he said, when he ascended up on high, he led captive. And gave what did he give?
Gave
gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, which
what?
Is it? But that he also descended first into lower parts of the earth. Then we say verse 10, please everybody together. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill things. Okay, verse 11. And he gave some what?
Apostles.
And then some
prophets.
And some
evangelists.
Some evangelists. and some
pastor
and teacher and teacher. For what purpose? Was for all. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Now, brothers and sisters, God, in His mercy, when He looked into the great challenge which His Son gave to the apostles, they were all from Galilee, and they did not know any other language, only Galilean. And the task was to go and preach the gospel to how many? To the whole world. And God, out of His mercy, granted them various gifts. At that time, God gave them the gift of what? Gift of tongues. So they could speak in different tongues wherever they went. I know one of the apostles went to India. His name is Thomas. And he did not know Galilean, but the Bible, according to the Bible, they all spoke according to the need of the congregation, the language which they could understand. So this apostle went to India, traveling from Jerusalem, going to Iraq, from Iraq to Iran. Neighborly, at that time was India, now it is Pakistan, going to Afghanistan and traveling. We do not know what means of travel he had. But then we find that as he was preaching on the other part of India, we call South India, he was martyred, Thomas. And many who are converted, they took the name of Thomas. And when you ask any South Indian, they must have the name. They may have another surname, but they would have the Thomas. They carry on the memory. So God gave different gifts to the church. And the purpose was to edify Jesus and to strengthen the church and to preach the gospel. Let me remind you, there are differences between the fruit of the Spirit and the gift of the Spirit. Do you agree with me? There are differences between the gifts of the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit. And the purpose of the gift is to preach the gospel and bring them to the conviction so they will accept Jesus Christ. And one who comes to Jesus Christ and gets baptized, what they should do? They should produce what? The fruit of the Spirit. One of the church which are going to discuss today is the Corinthian church. I want you to go to the letter of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And we find this church, this church is full of gift of the Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and we read from verse 4 onward. First of all, he writes this letter, and we read together. It says, verse 4, writing to them, I thank my God always on your behalf, by the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ, that in everything ye are enriched by Him, in all utterances and in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that ye come behind how many? Behind no gift, waiting for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. You find in this church, Corinthian church, Paul says, I thank God that you got all the gifts, all the gifts of the Spirit, even say the testimony of Christ, which is the gift of the prophecy. What a beautiful church. All the gifts, speaking in tongues, pastor, apostle, you name it, they have all the gifts. But the sermon is, take the gift, but produce the fruit. So what's happening in this church? They are having all the gifts of the Holy Spirit, but there is something lacking in this church. Not much fruit there. Because when you go a little further, chapter 3, please, chapter 3, verse 1, chapter 3, verse 1, and verse 3. Paul says, come on, let's read together. And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, every as unto babes in Christ. Then verse 3, please. For ye are yet carnal. For whereas there is among you, what is it? Envy and strife and reason. And ye are not carnal and walk as men. You see, you know, he used the word, very dangerous word. He says you have all the gift of the Spirit, but what are you? Yet you are carnal. And he says, I cannot speak to you as a spiritual people. You are still worldly at the moment. What I like to say, that the gift of the Spirit is not the guarantee that you are a spiritual person. Is that right? It makes it very clear. The church having all the gift of the Holy Spirit, but yet Paul says, when I look into the condition of the church, you are carnal. I cannot speak to you as a spiritual person. You know, it's a difference. You know, when you are spiritual minded, you can speak the spiritual, talk to the matter to them. And not only that, when you look into chapter 5, please. Chapter 5 and verse 1. I'm requesting you to read together so it's registered in your mind. Chapter 5, same letter, and verse 1. We read together. It is reported commonly that there is what? Fornication among you. And such fornication has not so much as named among where?
Gentiles.
That one should have his father's wife. It's a sad picture. Having the gift of the Spirit. So my brother and sister, Paul is warning us that having the spiritual gift is not a guarantee you are a spiritual man or woman. Let's go then further. The condition of the church. Chapter 6, please. Chapter 6, and we read together, verse 1 to 3. It is very, very interesting word which is used here, even with the beginning. What does it say? Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unjust, and not before the saints? Do you not know that the saints shall judge what?
The world?
Judge the world. And if the world shall be judged by you, are you unworthy
to
judge the small matter? Verse 3, please. Know ye not that ye shall judge what?
Angels.
how much more things that pertain to this life. Not that much. When you read verse 9, chapter 6, what was happening? The people, they were judging each other. They were judging each other. You are doing that. You are doing that. And verse 9, Paul has to remind them. What it says, verse 9? Come on, everybody together. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, not adulterers, not effeminate, not abusers of themselves with mankind, not thieves, not covetous, not drunkards, not revilers, not extortioners, shall inherit the kingdom of God. But then you read verse 11, what does it say? And such was some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. What he was trying to say, brethren, do not condemn the people, those are struggling. You are like those people too. But by the grace of God, you are washed now. What you are to do, present to Jesus, give them the love of Jesus. Don't condemn them. Remember where you are.
Amen.
It's a serious matter. Having the gift of the Spirit, but yet you are fallen. Not only that much. When you look into chapter 11, please. Chapter 11, verse 17. Chapter 11, verse 17. What's happening there? Chapter 11, verse 17. We read together when you are ready. It's just like encourage you to look into, read it, and chew it, and be careful. 17, verse 17. Everybody together? Now, in this that I declare unto you, pray ye not. I pray you not that ye come together, not for the battle, but for the worse. You know what's happening? Brethren, sometimes it happens to us too. We come from home prayerfully, hearing from the Lord, and when you go out of the church, you are worse in your thought, in your thinking, when you came to the church. The reason, somebody has said something to you. Somebody has, what should I say?
Disturb your
spirit. Our attitude in the church. Brethren, we've got to be careful. When we come to the church, we are coming to the house of the Lord.
Amen.
And he said, where two or three together, what did he say? I will be there. I hope that we will open our conscience, our heart, and when we come here among the brethren, we should feel that we are in the presence of God.
Amen.
Lot of condemnation, lot of things happen when we come to church. Be careful. You may be a talented person, I would not say, I would simply say, whatever you are a child of God, but behave like child of God.
Amen.
When we come to the church. There is no higher and lower. We are all servants here. And behave as a servant of Christ. So what's happening in this church now? Having all the gifts of the Spirit, okay? Verse 18. First of all, are you there, please?
Yes.
For first of all, when we come together in the church, I hear that there be what? The reason among you, and I partly believe it. And Pastor Masih, you have to believe it. partly division among you, and I believe it. Okay, verse 19. For there must be also what? Hear this among you. I pray that there's nobody here like that. Hearsay. You know what a hearsay? You say, I heard it from so and so. What you hear, if it's not in a Christian way, better shut your ear and close your eyes. Don't pass it on, but hearsay, not always good. Hearsay. Yeah. It says, 19, for there must be also hearsay among you, that they which are approved may be made manifest among you. Verse 20. When you come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. What's happening in that? They copied the heathen people. They would come to the church, and before they come to the communion service, they will have a good feast. And at that time, in the church, there were rich people, and there were poor people, so much so, there were some slaves also, those who accepted the law. And when they come to feast, what was happening there? Look here. Verse 20, are you there? Yeah. When you come together, therefore, unto one place, there is not to eat the Lord's Supper, for in eating everyone taketh before others his own supper. Here was some rich people. They have, I don't know what they have cooked, but they have something good food. They are sitting here on the left side, and some are sitting on the other side, and there are some slaves sitting far beyond them. We would call them in my country, we call them untouchable. So everybody is enjoying them, but some of them, they have come to church, but they are not able to bring any food there. So everybody is enjoying themselves. You know where? In the house of God. I had a sad experience once. In the church we were eating, and all of a sudden, one came, knocked the door of the church. It was cold like this. Hair, not combed. Clothes, dirty. And somebody said, who's that? Tell him to go away. No. If you know, we pray, give us daily bread, isn't it? That is not just for you. You better share with somebody too. Right. So it says here, for in verse 21, for in eating everyone taketh before other his own supper, and one is what? Hungry, and other one is thirsty. And yet they have the gift of the Holy Spirit. Right. And then Paul writes down and says, when you come, when you're ready for the communion service, I will not go further, but let's see what's happening there now. Chapter 12. This so far is the so poor spiritual condition of the church, yet having the gift of the Holy Spirit. But now what's happening? They are abusing the gift of the Holy Spirit. Why? Let me say. Okay, chapter 12, please. Chapter 12, verse 27. Everybody together? Chapter 12, verse 27. No. Paul is saying, chapter 12, verse 27, Paul is saying, now are the body of Christ and members in particular. And God has sent some in the church, and the apostles, secondary prophets, and then teachers, and the miracles, and the healing, health, government, and diversities of tongues. He says, yes, you got those gifts. But what's happening? Everybody is claiming that they got all the gifts. No, it happened. It's my nature to be everywhere, but not to be as others, but be in their company sometimes. I visit unforbidden places. Don't misunderstand, not to do what for the things. Yeah. Because there are souls too.
Amen.
I visit other churches, I take services, and it was my privilege to visit one church especially. And the reason was, it was a discussion that Pastor Masih, if you cannot speak in tongues, you do not have the Holy Spirit, and you are not saved person. So I took my time to visit that church. I attended the service, and you know what was happening? There was a session where everybody would speak tongues. And I didn't understand, but everybody speaking tongues. Everybody was speaking tongues. And after that session, there comes a session of prophecy. Everybody has to give the message, what message you have received. And before they go any further, one young man, this happened in India. And I would not name the place where it was. One young man stood up, the prophecy taking place. He said, I have a message. Everybody got alert, because by profession he was a doctor. He stood up and said, I got the message that I had to marry that sister. And lo and behold, that sister, she did not hold it, said, I have a message, he should not come near to me. Now, this was an abuse of the gift of the Spirit. So Paul has to say, when everybody was claiming that they are prophets, they are preachers, everybody has all the gifts. Go to verse 29. Paul has to abuse them in his spiritually. He said, come on now, everybody together, verse 29.
All apostles,
are all prophets, are all teachers, are all merchants of miracles, have all the gifts of healing, do all speak the tongues, do all interpret, but cover earnestly the best gift, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. So brethren, let nobody deceive you. Let nobody deceive you that if they can speak in tongues, if they can make a prophecy, they are saved people. The guarantee is that when you are baptized, you must have the fruit of the Spirit. Gift of the Spirit is up to the Holy Spirit, whom they want to give. Even you know the donkey in the Old Testament, the donkey, they spoke a different language. And the Garden of Eden, the devil spoke a different language. But praise God, God gave this gift for one purpose, to edify the church.
Amen.
Not to lift yourself who you are. Sometimes we are tempted. If you're a good preacher, everybody praise you. And you got lifted up. And you look down with others, those who cannot reach like you. These are the gifts, it's not yours. These gifts can be given, can be taken away.
Oh yes.
And don't altar, we should raise it. Sister White said the church members should remember 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse chapter 13. We must remember that. It should keep us humble. Go to chapter 13 now. Chapter 13, 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Chapter 13. It says, are you there? Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not what? Charity means love. If I have not the love, I am become what? As sounding brass or a twinkling cymbal. Some people would say, when you don't understand the language, they would say, I am speaking angel
language.
So Paul said, doesn't matter, even if I could speak those, but if I do not have what? If I do not have love, love is the fruit of the Spirit. Colossians chapter 5. Love is the fruit of the Spirit. But if you don't have the love, you can speak. But then he says, I'm like what? Like a cymbal, is it? Brass. Sounding brass. I am become as sounding brass or a twinkling cymbal. Yes. I would say, why does he say that? This piano? What do you call it? Is it piano? Or?
Piano.
Come on, tell me, am I ignorant?
Piano.
Piano, right. Piano can give a good tune. Very nice tune. But it has no feeling. It has no emotion. So it's not a human being. So anybody who would say, I can speak good, but that's not a guarantee, brethren. Have the gift, but you must produce the fruit. Then go further. And though I have the gift of what?
Prophecy
and understanding all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains and have not what? Love, I am nothing. So my friend, miracles are not a sign of a converted person. It's not me, the Bible says. You must have the fruit. You know, when you say fruit of the Spirit, how many fruit we have? How many fruit of the Spirit we have?
Love.
How many?
Love.
How many? How many, please?
Love, joy.
Fruit of the Spirit is only one fruit, please. And that is love. Go to Galatians, please. Yes, please. Galatians, chapter 5. Galatians, chapter 5. Okay. Chapter 5. Right. And verse, where you are, you start with what? Chapter 20, no, verse 22, is it? Yes, 22. It says, but the fruit, it doesn't say the fruits. Does it say fruits or fruit?
Singular.
Only one. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is what?
Love.
Once you have the love, it the other things develop then slowly. The joy, etc. Yes. Love, joy, peace, long suffering, gentleness, good manner, goodness, faith, and so on. So love is important. Love is the best. When you start loving somebody, brother and sister, you will bear it. You will not, what I would say, you will not divorce a person because you love that person. We are doing a discussion in the Sabbath school. When love goes away, then everything goes away. Heart becomes empty. Christ is not here. Then comes the separation. But the Bible says, love suffers how much?
Oh.
Chapter 13, please go back and give glory. Chapter 13. Chapter 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Yeah. Chapter 13. Verse 4. Chapter 13, verse 4. Everybody together now. Love. Charity suffers. How long? It does not say that much. There is no end. When there is love, then you suffer, but how long? No end. There is no cut there. You suffer. Long enough so you have a place in heaven. Charity suffers long and is kind and weeth not. Wanteth not itself, is not puffed up, do not behave itself unseemly. So love is important. So I hope and pray that lot of things are happening in the family. You know, when you speak with your partner, even if the partner is wrong, be patient. When you are angry, that God will open your mouth.
Amen.
When discord or disagreement comes, you watch over. All the children with you, when you are speaking to your partner, if you are using the insulting words in front of your children to your partner, you are encouraging your children to behave like that. You are telling the honor that you should be giving to each other. You are challenging them. You are destroying them. You are opening it. So the charity, the love, suffers long. Time is up. God bless you.
Amen.
At this time, I would like to thank Pastor Masih for allowing God to use him again to share the message he had for this morning.
Oh, for that day of living fire, which shone so bright in the saints of old, which men from age to
Father, we thank you. Deep down in our hearts, Lord, there's a desire to follow you. But I pray, Lord, that you will bless your church, especially your congregation here. Grant us, Lord, that by your grace, we will humble ourselves. We give ourselves all to the feet of Jesus. Then, Lord, please bring the revival among us, in our homes, in our individual lives, in the church. So that your church, Lord, your body would be a glorious body, having the fruit, having the love within us, with brother and sister, and also the members of the community. Give us that force, give us that power which you gave your disciples. They were humble, they were willing to sacrifice their lives for the cause which you have given to them. I pray, Father, that you will hear our prayers in the lovely name of Jesus Christ, and we will say, Amen.